Let's talk to the executive director of the Henry Jackson Society, Dr. Alan Mendoza. Good evening, Alan.
Good evening, Kevin.
So nice noises from the government. Too many schools are going down this worrying path of extreme wokeism, teaching kids as young as 5 and 6 and 7 critical race theory. If they're white, telling little white kids, you may not realise it, but you're racist because you're the recipient of white privilege. All of this stuff, decolonising the curricula. Now, this tends to lead to a suppression of certain points of view. In other words, a cancellation of free speech. Government warning schools, if you do that, we will fine you. Well, I'll believe that when I see it, because they keep talking the talk about tackling wokery, but they never seem to walk the walk. Is that a worry to you?
Well, don't forget there's a new law that's coming into play on this, which will see free speech championed in a very different way, where, as you say, these fines will be able to be taken up. They will be able to be challenged. People will suffer as a result if they do close down free speech. So I think we have to wait for that to kick in before we make a judgment as to whether this is all hokum or actually there's some real change occurring. It is quite clear that the government does see this as an issue and wants to make significant change in the university sector. And you've quite rightly highlighted that the university sector is one such place to look at, but actually schools are in a completely different position. At least in universities, you have a lot of people who are willing to challenge, at least superficially, the situation. In schools, what do the kids do? They're stuck in a system where it's very difficult to monitor what's going on and really to challenge what is being said by, you know, what you're being taught. So I think it is necessary for the government to take a greater interest in this and also to look at the national curriculum being enforced in a proper and correct manner. And, you know, those who step out of line and try and, you know, teach deviant things need to be called to account.
The universities that allowed intense no platforming to go on, which was usually not all guests could be sanctioned in terms of or justified in terms of what they were going to say. But in most cases of no platforming, when speakers were supposed to go to universities and the students decided they would infringe on their safe space, they didn't want to hear whatever the speaker was going to say. When the university went along with the students and said, OK, that person can't speak here, that was against the law. It was against the law. It was against our law of free speech. Not a single university chancellor or vice chancellor has ever been sanctioned on that front. So the government does not have a great record about actually walking the walk when it comes to tackling this kind of absurd wokery and this assault on our basic freedoms, as in the freedom of expression and the freedom of speech.
Well, you're right, but that's why I think this new sort of development in this area, the new legislation, is going to make a big difference. Because I think in the past, they were scared, presumably, of tackling, as you say, the manifest breaches that were occurring. Now there's a clear mechanism for how to do it. I mean, who was going to call them to account? Was it the Secretary of State for Education? Was it the Higher Education Funding Authority? Who was going to actually do it? Now there's a path. It's going to go to the Office of Students, to the new free speech czar, if you like, who's going to investigate it, who's going to decide what's had to happen here. And that's really, I think, the big difference right now, that there's a mechanism. Now, if they don't take the mechanism, and that's, you know, very much up in the air, of course, then we'll know what you've been saying is correct. And it's only a game, and actually they don't care. But there have been cases recently. I mean, you've highlighted, obviously, you know, some of the things that are happening with CRT, other things in schools. But you've had crazy examples, obviously the Batley Grammar case, you know, where a teacher fell foul of, you know, free speech issues, where he wasn't protected by either his school or by the government in that way. A shocking departure. Will he be protected by these laws? Will the headmistress who had to apologise in Manchester for having wanted to give a donation to the British Red Cross, which was fairly giving money to both Israeli civilians and Palestinian civilians affected in the recent Gaza conflict, she had to apologise because she was deemed to be racist for wanting to help the Israelis. Is she going to get protection? I mean, it works in interesting ways, this. And once you start unpacking it, you begin to understand there's a heck of a lot going on in our schools that needs careful monitoring.
I mean, do you think it's right that the National Education Union, for example, is absolutely advocating that kids as young as 5 and 6 and 7 should be taught critical race theory, should be taught all about white privilege, should be taught about trans rights? This is a hijacking of the curriculum. Why don't they just teach them, their maths and their English and their geography like they used to?
Kevin, exactly. I've got to tell you, I don't think it's whether kids are 5, 6, 7. I don't think anyone should be studying critical race theory. This is, theory that's come from the fringes of academia, that's therefore been pushed into the mainstream by an aggressive campaign to normalize it. As you say, the serious subjects, it's not as if we're doing so well in those necessarily. And suddenly these are being pushed aside for this, kind of new age hokum. Come on, this is crazy stuff. How is that going to help you, anyone, kind of getting engaged in the economy and society beyond? This is a pet project of a few, kind of crazed individuals who frankly want to foist their theories on everyone else. They've seen an opportunity to do it. They're being disgracefully assisted by elements of the of the teaching profession and of various unions. But it's a nakedly political goal when, in fact, we all know the purpose of children being in school is to actually educate them about real life issues, as opposed to pet theories of marginal academics.
Well, this is a clear and present danger that this white privilege critical race theory thinking is going to become a reality in our schools pretty damn soon, unless the government does something about it. Do you think that this new law will allow and maybe embolden the government to really take a stand and to stand up against this kind of what I would view as insane wokery?
Well, I would hope so. Although, again, there's two sorts of different things here. It's all obviously about control of the curriculum, what happens in schools versus, of course, and universities versus kind of appeals processes and ways to stop it. I would like to think that when the first fines start getting handed out, when the first kind of admonitions occur, that the embarrassment factor is going to cause people to row back and go, right, this social engineering has got real world consequences. And that's, I think, the aim we have to get to. We have to show people that if you do start to act in this way, if you do start to enforce these fringe theories on people, it's this is not what education's about. And there ought to be a way for government to step in and say, sorry, you've overstepped the limit here. We are going to take charge and kick your theories back to the sidelines where they belong.
And universities, we hope, will be informed that unless in extreme circumstances, in other words, someone preaching racism or violence, that no platforming speakers who have legitimate viewpoints that the students may not agree with is illegal.
Well, this is the thing. I mean, it's a question of where you take illegal, basically. So no one's going to get jailed, obviously, for it, but there has to be sanctions.
What's the pity, Henry, Alan? Sorry.
Well, it would be fun. It would be entertaining if that were the case, if people got jailed for no platforming. But look, again, this is an infringement in one sense, because if you're in an educational establishment, you should be interested in hearing points of view, yes, particularly from those who you don't agree with, if only to challenge your own ideas and to go, actually, I'm more comfortable and more confident in my ideas because I've actually tested them against people who disagree. What I find fascinating is that the people who want to know platform appear to be very unconfident in their ideas. They don't want to be challenged. They don't want people to hear the other side of the debate. And that's what's so pathetic about the whole thing. This is about cancelling, if you like, free speech, cancelling other sides of view, because you know full well that your arguments are not strong enough to stand up against them. And that's particularly why we have to get in there and make sure that students are, hear all points of view and can make their own minds up once they've heard those points of view, rather than being, kind of fed propaganda from any particular side.
Couldn't agree more. I'm glad you brought up, Alan, earlier, the issue of the Batley Grammar School teacher who remains in hiding in terror for his life with his wife and his kids 4 months after upsetting the local Muslim community there. He didn't do anything wrong. He's still in hiding. The school has actually exonerated him now, but not only has he is he refusing to go into that school, so is the rest of the religious education department. That's two other teachers as well, because they're so fearful about the Muslim community. So the school is saying the teacher can come back, but not surprisingly and kind of understandably, he's rather worried to do so. Now, that man has not done anything wrong. He's not broken any laws. He had the temerity to try to teach his kids about blasphemy, perfectly legitimate topic in a religious education lesson. What is to be done for this poor man?
Well, the whole saga was a disgrace, in the sense of the school should never have suspended him in the first place. They caved into the extremists straight away. As you said, he did nothing wrong. He was exonerated. I mean, what a terrible thing to say, exonerated of nothing. There was, you know, in the sense of he did nothing wrong, he shouldn't have been exonerated. But in the meantime, of course, his life is very much in the balance. You know, he's been threatened. The police clearly believe there is still a present danger. He can't walk back into that school, and he knows it. The other teachers are equally concerned. I believe at least one other teacher has been suspended as well for having done something similar. So it's quite clear that we have a major problem in schools where teachers are unable to teach basic concepts in this country without coming under threat for their lives. And just think about that for a second, Kevin. We're sitting here, you know, quite comfortably, in a sense. We would think it perfectly normal to be able to argue about free speech, give it illustrations, examples of how to do it. We wouldn't expect to have our lives threatened as a result of it. But these teachers have that issue. They're really on the front lines of this. And, you know, I think in a sense, the school should have been put under special measures. It was outrageous that he was kind of actually investigated in the first place. The board of governors should have been chopped and changed. The Department of Education should have gotten involved and said, there's something very rotten in your school that is happening. And they ought to have done something much stronger than what's happened. And of course, second factor is, look how nobody spoke about it.
I was going to say, Alan, that you would hope that the new MP for Batley and Spen, Kim Leadbeater, the Labour victorious candidate, would go into Parliament and finally speak up for this poor guy who remains in hiding and in terror for his life. But considering she never had the guts to mention him once throughout her entire campaign, I'm not going to bet the farm on that. But somebody has to do something about this. It is an ongoing scandal, and perhaps we will talk of it again. Thank you so much for your time. Always a pleasure to talk, Alan. Dr. Alan Mendoza, Executive Director of the Henry Jackson Society. I'm Kevin O'Sullivan, and this is Talk Radio.